Hello friends, welcome to this interesting session of linear regression from Edureka side. This is going to be a very interesting session. You might have heard about this term a lot that, there is something called as linear regression, and especially in the machine learning side. And you must be in fact wondering that, what is this topic about? It is so hot these days that there is no interview in machine learning which is complete without the talk of linear regression. So if you go and plan for any interview of machine learning, you can expect that this is going to be the almost the first question in all your interview questions. So this is so important topic. So we are going to understand that step by step, what exactly is linear regression. We are also not only just going to do that, we are going to see a demo in the end. So it's going to be very interesting in all those terminologies that first we will see that why this is important, why companies are stressing over it. We will see multiple examples of how linear regression works, what are the important components in it. So let's explore that. Now, as I said, what all we are going to learn? We are going to learn about machine learning. Then we are going to understand what is regression. Because before even talking about what is linear regression, we are going to talk about what is regression. We will also see what kind of regressions we have, what are the type of regressions we have available. There are a few linear regression examples which we are going to walk through. Few use cases, we will be understanding. With that, we will get a very good idea about where we kind of use this linear regression. Then in the end, we will see a demo. Interesting, right? So we are going to follow all that. Now let's start with machine learning. Now you must have heard this buzzword a lot. What is this machine learning? You must have heard this terminology a lot, but what exactly is that? Now, to talk about it, all of you must have heard the name of Amazon, right? All of you must have heard the name of Amazon, Flipkart, eBay, or any of the e-commerce website, what you can take up as your example. What happens in Amazon? If you log into your account, have you noticed that they show you recommendation products, right? Yes. So you will see a lot of recommended products. Now, if you log out from your system, from that recommended product, and log in with your friend's account in the same system, now with high probability, are you going to get the same recommended product or different recommended product? Different recommended product, right? Now, that means what? That means Amazon is not hard coding it for sure, right? They're not hard coding it. Then there must be something what they must be doing for this. What is that something? So this problem is actually solved with the help of machine learning algorithms. So with the help of machine learning algorithms, based on a lot of categories, for example, based on your previous bot history, what window shopping you are doing there, right? Lot of things, lot of activities they're tracking. And based on that, they will be using a smart machine learning algorithm. They are able to predict that what exactly is the likely product which you will be buying. Now, this is something which can be done with the help of machine learning. Now, this is interesting, right? Because let me tell you that there was actually an official statement from Amazon, which came sometime back, where they even stated that this machine learning, this recommended products have helped them in increasing the revenue by 60%. Now imagine a company like Amazon, who's making so much of money already, and this machine learning is helping them to increase their revenue by 60%, which is actually a very good and huge number. Now, this is the power of machine learning. Not only this, even a lot of other companies are using machine learning these days. For example, if you are, let's say, trying to bring a new product to the market, before even launching that product, before even taking that risk of putting that product in the market, applying machine learning, you can predict beforehand itself whether this is going to make profit or loss. Don't you think? This is much better than all your astrologists and all who used to predict your future, right? If we can give this assurance with a good probability, any probability which is greater than 50%, definitely that algorithm is good, right? Because in that case, you are able to even predict more than 50% that, this is going to make me profit or loss. You can even predict till 80%, that's 80-90%. Don't you think that's a good model what you can generate, right? So that's the power of machine learning. So you can do a lot of things. In fact, it is said that within 5 years, whichever company who works on data related stuff if they will not use machine learning, they will not be able to survive for long in the market. That is one thing which is being said about this machine learning, that within next five years, if none of the companies who are not using have yet not moved to the machine learning side, they will not be able to survive in the market. Now here comes the first challenge. The thing is, if you talk about different domains, like for example, I can talk about, let's say, big data. You might have heard that this term is getting used a lot these days, right? Now we can talk about even, let's say, Apache Spark, right? Which is also related to your big data domain. Now, if I talk about all these components, now definitely this big data, if we talk about, this is a buzzword and a lot of jobs are booming in this market. If you go and search about it, you will get thousands of trainings available for you, and a lot of people are now no big data in Apache Spark. So though there are more jobs, but there are people available to fill it up. That is actually there for this big data side. But when it comes to machine learning, there are more jobs and in fact less amount of people who can fill in that gap. And there's a reason for it, because learning machine learning is a little tricky task. I'm pretty sure from this batch itself, if I ask you, there may be around few people who will say that I have tried learning machine learning and I gave up in middle. Anyone? Very good, Dinesh. So I can see few people are saying yes. So that usually happens, that you try to learn it from the free materials available outside, and then you just simply give up. The reason being, it's not like machine learning is complicated as for me. It's just that you are not getting the proper way to learn it. You are not learning it in the right way. It's not tough. Even the mathematics involved is not tough. People make it sound tough. It is not tough actually at all. Now, because of this, a lot of people give up. But let me just tell you that if you know this, definitely you have the best chance of getting a very high salary job in this market. So that's basically all about machine learning side. So I hope I have to motivate you on this part. But basically, that's the truth in the market. You can easily go and explore it, that we have more jobs and less people. And that's the reason machine learning engineers are highly paid people. They are very highly paid people. Now, if I move further, what exactly we do in machine learning? So in machine learning, we require data. Without data, we can't do anything in machine learning. That's one very important point. Without data, you cannot do anything in machine learning. So what we generally do, initially, whatever data we get, we call it as a training data. What do I mean by training data? Because with the help of some old data, we are going to make our algorithm learn. We are going to tell that the algorithm is going to learn from that data. Okay, if the value is this, then the output is this. If the value is this, the output is this. So there will be lot and lot of data from where it is going to learn. Once it learns from that perspective, once it learns from the data, okay, if this value is this, the output should be this. Then if you give any new value to it, it will be able to predict that this should be the new outcome. That is overall how machine learning works. If you look at this diagram, which is in front of you, you can easily note that we are going to have a training data set. As I said, so training data set is the one on which you are kind of trying to create some sort of rule, which we are going to call it as a model for us. Now, we are trying to create some rule, just like, okay, if this is my input, this is, should be my output. If this is my input, this should be my output. Something of that rule which we are creating. So we are making our algorithm learn. We are building the model from here. Then we are going to perform our operations on it. And then we can keep on improvising our algorithm as well. So we give the feedback, again go back to it. What exactly is happening here? So what happened? When you made your algorithm learn, it's not like that you get the right output at the same time. No, it's not happens like that. You need to keep on training it. You need to keep on again building the model. Then see that, okay, if there is everything is right or wrong. And if you see that, okay, it can be improved further, then you will again with more data, you can keep on trying it. You will keep on performing your models. You will keep on predicting it and see that if we are making our model better and better. So this iteration will keep on happening. And that is the overall cycle of machine learning looks like. This is just a general cycle, which I just explained to you. We'll explore this in more detail as and when we will move further. Now, if we take some example, I just give you a nice example about Amazon. Similarly, if you talk about Facebook, even not only Facebook, you take any company, these days any big company, they are actually investing big into machine learning domain. Let's start with Facebook example. Like if you notice your personalized each member's feed, right? That is done by machine learning. When you upload the kind of photos on Facebook, have you noticed that they start saying that, you know, this user is most likely this, right? They start suggesting immediately. How do you think it's happening? Do you think they know you personally? No, it's impossible for Facebook to know you personally, right? Still, how they're able to do it? Because they're applying machine learning algorithms at the back end to identify who is this person. So with your previous photos or whatever you have uploaded, they are trying to see the features, and whichever features are matching with your pic, they are telling that, okay, this person is most likely this. Similarly, they are using all this for the news feeds, in advertisement as well. Now in advertisement, machine learning plays a major role these days. Now, if you want to target the right audience, because definitely I don't want to target everyone, right? If I send email, my marketing email to everyone, it is going to be a very bad idea, right? Because it is going to incur a lot of cost for me, which I definitely don't want to have, right? So in that case, I would prefer to send target only few specific people. And how I can do that? I can again do that with the help of machine learning. So these are things, even the trending news, you might have noticed that, okay, this is trending news. Even those trending news, if I want to target, I can do that. Even so in your friend recommendation, which is, I think, very famous, not only in Facebook, but also in LinkedIn, right? You get a lot of friends recommendations. That also part is done with the help of machine learning. So they predict, if you have this friend, then most likely this will also be a friend. So they are able to do that with the help of machine learning. As I said, it's not only Facebook or Amazon. You can take any big company example. Means I'm taking big company example. It doesn't mean that only big company use it. Even smaller companies use that. But I'm taking this example in a general way so that you can correlate easily. I don't know how many of you have heard this statement from Sundar Pichai, who is the CEO of Google. Just few months back, there was a statement from him that they are going to invest big now on machine learning and artificial intelligence. Any of you heard that? Good to know it, that few of you have already heard this as well. So basically, they are going to invest quite big. Even if you Google, you will get that news. You can just easily Google that Sundar Pichai is saying that Google is going to invest big on machine learning in AI. What does that mean? That means they are going to hire more and more people who knows machine learning. So they are going to invest on people who are good with machine learning side. That means when they said that they are going to invest very big on that. Now, if you talk about Google, even they use advertisement, they have a lot of things. In fact, even in the Google search, they apply machine learning when they show you the news feeds and all, right? So there also they use machine learning that all the common news should cluster together. So all those things is done basically with the help of machine learning. And each company, if they want to make profit, if they want to become best company for tomorrow, they are thinking towards machine learning side. They are all moving towards machine learning side because they can easily predict without applying machine learning algorithm that this is going to be the future. And if we use this, we can in fact kind of recover from our losses. We can make more profit. So this is going to definitely be of great help to do that. Even forget about all this. If you are from the startup background, right? You must have heard about these investors and all, right? Venture investor list and all. They are also using machine learning to predict that if you go and say that, okay, I am a startup, I do this blah, 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 blah. I want investment from you. What they simply do? They will ask a balance sheet and all. They will put that in their machine learning algorithm and they will be able to tell whether you are going to make profit or loss. Simple thing they are doing. This part, in fact, I have personally seen when I actually visited one of the investor, that guy was not even hearing any of the thing. Based on the estimation, what his machine algorithm said, he just decided whether to invest or not. Okay, so this is a few more examples, as I said. So there will be lot many like this, where companies are investing into machine learning in order to make more profits for their future. And everybody is in the market to make more profit, right? Now, let's move further. What is regression? Now let's talk about regression. We have talked a lot about machine learning and all. Now regression is just a part of machine learning. There are a lot of things in machine learning, starting from regression, clustering. There are so many things we can keep talking about. But this session we are focusing on regression, and especially linear regression. Okay, so we are going to focus mainly on the linear regression side, so that you can get a good idea how things work there. Now, when we talk about regression, what happens is you are going to have the relation between two variables of, let's say, a data set, and you gonna define the model based on that. For example, let's say if I say that, okay, my input value is something this and output value is this. In fact, let me give you a better example what is in front of you so that you can get an idea how this regression works, or in fact how the linear regression also looks like. In my company, actually, we are using it. So I think this make more sense when I show you this example, because we have developed and gave it to our HR. Let's say if I have a situation like this, let me do one thing. Let me open my paint. If you understood this, you will find the rest of the slides very easy. So let's see this. So in our company, what we actually do is, let's say if I have this kind of data. What kind of data? Let's understand that. So if you are a manager, or if you are, in fact, as an interviewee also, you might have done that. When a lot of times, when you go for an interview, and in the end, when you get selected and everything, and HR says that, can you tell me what's the expected salary? You say, I want the salary as per company standard. I'm pretty sure a lot of among you might be doing that, right? Or if you are already a manager, you might have already seen it a lot of times that candidates come and say that I want the salary as per company standard. Now here comes the challenge. When anybody say that I want the salary as per company standard, what should I make out of it? What should I make out of this? That what should I give the salary to him? Now to do this, let's say I have some data set of my previous employees. Now that data set looks like this. Let's say this x-axis denote the experience. Let's say this is 1 year experience. This is 2 year experience. This is 3 year experience. This is 4 year experience. This is 5 year experience. And on the y-axis, let's say some salaries depend. Let's say this is $30K US. I know this is very less, but let's take it up. Let's say this is $40K US. Let's say this is $50K US. This is $60K US, and maybe much more. But let's assume this is my data. Now, let's say you have this data plotted like this. I will explain you what does this mean actually. That data set what you're gonna have will be in a form of table, right? So your data set will be in a form of table. So I will explain you first of all what exactly, why I'm plotting like this. So let me add some point here also. Some point here also. Okay, let me explain you what is this. So let's say you're in your company, you have definitely you're going to have some previous employees, right? So in that case, what's happening in this case is, let's say a person who is having 0 year experience is, let's say, making 30K salary. Okay, let's say 0 year experience guy is making 30K salary. Now, definitely in a company, it's not like that everyone of 1 year experience are going to get same salary, right? Sometimes it do happen that a person is getting more, somebody may be getting less, right? All these things do happen. Now, in this data set, if you notice, let's say 1 year experience, if I consider, one guy is there who is making, let's say, around 36K or 38K. One guy is there who is making, let's say, around 40K, right? So you can notice that 1 year experience guy is getting this salary. Similarly, all these points denotes the year of experience with respect to the salary part. Now what we should do? Now in this case, if I have to estimate that what is the salary which we should be offering to, let's say, a guy to 2 year experience, how can I do that? 2 year experience guy came up to you and said that I want to have the salary as per company standard. What should be the salary which we should give him? Do you think we should do an average of these salaries? Now, if you notice the average part, there is a problem here. Notice the problem. The first person is making around 35K. Second person is making around 40K. Third person is making around 45K. Can you notice these two points? 60K and around 55K. Don't you think these two, because of these two, my average is going to increase a lot? In fact, my average is going to fall somewhere here, right? So that is something which we want to avoid. Because if we use average, the problem will be these outliers, because there are like too much outside points which are going to impact the overall output. So average is not going to work. What should we do next? We are going to apply our linear regression method. Whatever linear regression method going to do? Linear regression method is going to identify a line out of it. It should be a straight line, okay? I am not just drawing it properly. So it's, in fact, let me draw it. Let's see if I can draw it properly. Okay, let me use this. So I need a line which should pass from all the points. Now in that case, what should be the output? If a 2-year experience guy come up, we will say, okay, let's see this. So this is the salary what we should drop off, 42K. Now you may ask another question, why this 42K? Because if I see from HR perspective, HR would love to have this line. Definitely, right? HR would love to have this line, while the candidate would love to have this line. Then how should we decide that this red color line is the right line, not these other two lines? Okay, so we will understand that part. So that how we basically decide that, just let me give you a little bit of idea, but we are going to see this in our slides also how to do that. So what we actually do is, in linear regression, we kind of consider all these lines. And then what we do, we found out the error. What is that error? Let me show you this part with the help of the slide itself, so that it will be more clear to you. So if I go back to my PPT, now look at this diagram. So if you look at this diagram, let's say this is my points, okay? Because this is more cleaner, that's why I brought you here. So this is my predicted value for, let's say, 5.9, okay? So let's say this is my predicted value, which is what? Let's say around 110. If I consider this is my actual value. What is this value? Around 113. From 113 to 110, there is a difference of 3. This part is called as residual. Okay, so this part is called as residual. Means the error margin between the predicted point and my actual point is called as residual. Now what we do actually here is, we are going to calculate the sum of square of all these residual. What I mean by sum of square? So in this case, can you notice that my residual was 3? So I'm going to say 3 the whole square plus, consider these points. Now there's an error margin here also. So let's say this error margin is of 1. 1 the whole square. Consider this point. There is an error margin of, let's say, 1 plus 1 the whole square. Keep on doing this for all the points. Now let's say the final output what you get here is, let's say, 150. Okay. Similar kind of thing I'm going to conclude from all the other lines as well. Whichever line is going to give me minimal with this value, I am going to consider that line and gonna say that this line is my perfect line. Everyone clear on this part? How your regression basically works? So in this, I have tried to explain you regression as well as your sum portion of linear regression, so that you can understand how linear regression can even solve your complicated problem. Thanks for all confirming this part. That you all are clear? Great. Now, so as I said, if you notice what's happening, we are predicting something, right? We are able to predict something, some future point we are predicting, because now, let's say I want to say that I want to get the value, let's say, for this one, let's say for around 6.9. Now I don't have any actual value, but still I can predict that for 6.9, it should come around 122, right? So I will be able to predict now the future part, because I have developed some sort of model for it. So I will be able to predict the future. That is what we are going to do. So let's go back. So in regression, we can develop a predictive modeling technique, as we have just seen. It defines the relation between your dependent variables and your independent variables. Now, what are dependent variables and independent variables? So let's say you want to predict what in the last example? You want to predict the salary, right? Now your salary is your dependent variable. Now, if I consider about independent variable, like for example, if I say my experience, now my experience is independent, but definitely if as and when my experience will increase, my salary is going to increase, right? So definitely salary is a dependent variable on, let's say, your experience part. So that is what we mean by dependent and independent variable here. Let's move further. Now let's see types of regressions. So we have multiple type of regression, starting with, we have linear regression, which we have just discussed, where you can see in this example, in fact, this is more clearer example, where we have these all green points as actual values, and this red line is my model, means it's my predicted line on which I can now do any regression. Logistic regression. This is also called as classification. In classification, you talk in terms of output like true and false. Let's take an example of Gmail. So I hope everybody of you have a Gmail account, right? Have you noticed that they give you something called as spam, right? Now in spam, what happens? All your junk emails kind of goes inside your spam. What kind of emails you generally notice in your spam box? What kind of emails generally goes in your spam box? Can I get an answer? You must have seen, right? Your spam email box. What kind of email generally goes? Very good. Marketing emails. What else? Marketing emails. Or sometimes they say that, congratulations, you became millionaire. Leave your job and enjoy the life. Just give us your all the personal details. Right? So that kind of emails. Congratulations, you have won iPhone 7. Now you need not sell your kidney to get that iPhone. So all those kind of emails. Right? So all those kind of emails what you get in your spam box. Right? Now, these kind of emails, like the features what you collect, so basically the characteristics what you collect of those emails, which generally goes to your spam box, is called your features. We call it as feature in our classification models in our machine learning language. Using that feature only, your Google is predicting that whether a new email which is coming to your email box, whether it's a spam email or a non-spam email. So what Google is doing, they are using machine learning algorithm here. So basically to identify when a new email comes up, whether it's a spam email or a non-spam email. Can you see the output we are getting in a true and false kind of thing, right? It's a spam email, true or false, right? So that's the reason we call it as logistic regression. So we are going to also call it as classification. Polynomial regression. When we have more than one variables, you have, let's say, a lot of independent variables, and in fact here, if you notice this line, we are getting this line also as a curved, right? We are not getting as a linear line. So when you can kind of square up the values, it sounds something like this. If my linear regression sounds like this, y is equal to mx plus c. Remember your school days mathematics, y is equal to mx plus c denotes a first time. So in this case, your polynomial regression is going to denote mx plus x square plus x cube, something like that. Okay, plus here also maybe some coefficients are there. So basically you are doing a polynomial kind of equation. So that is what happens in your polynomial regression. Let's move further. Now let's explore this linear regression. Basically linear regression, this is how my equation looks like. As I said, y is equal to mx plus c, we can denote also. But in this case, if you notice, I have denoted the equation like beta naught, beta x plus epsilon. Reason being, because we also want to denote this random error which fits in when you do your linear regression. We have seen this errors, right? So basically we just want to denote that also. That's the reason we are doing that. So definitely when you are designing this kind of line, you're going to have a slope also, right? Because if you notice, this is going to give you some theta slope. Right? So that is also we are denoting here. Now the slope in this case, we are defining this beta 1. I have written it as theta, but it's denoted as beta 1 in this line. Similarly, you have intercept, means like I said in that last example, let's say a person starting with zero salary, a 0 year experience, he's starting with 30 year salary, right? So this value is your intercepts. Okay. So that is what we mean here. So this is how you can define a linear regression. We have already understood this part in our example already. Moving further, let's see what is this gentleman is speaking. This gentleman is saying that I have a data set consisting of height and weight of the students. Let's see how would linear regression fit into it. Let me in fact give you an example. I forgot the name of that basketball player. Actually, this linear regression example came up from there only. So there was a guy who was very tall and he used to play basketball. Definitely, usually it happens, right? When you are tall, most likely your children will also be taught. I'm not saying definitely it's going to happen, but with a high probability that is going to happen, right? That if you are tall, your children will most likely are going to be tall only. In that case, from that basically person, people were predicting that his son is also going to be taller, and that was exactly true also. Now, then they thought that if this is true, let us see that if we want to predict for a new person, whether his son is going to be tall or small, can we do that? So that all, this is how this linear regression thing started. Now we are going to have a very similar example where we are going to, let's say if I'm going to give you some data set where I'm giving you height and weight of the students, and we want to see that whether this linear regression is going to infer something from it. Okay, so let's understand this example. Now in this case, let's say if we have a data set of these 10 students, as I have already explained you. Now we want to kind of understand, is there any sort of relation between this height and weight? Let's see that. Okay, so in this example, we want to, let's say, find any relation between height and weight. So if we plot this, if we plot all this point, let's say on x-axis I can plot height, on y-axis I can plot weight. So I'm just plotting on this point. So this is how my point will appear, right? Now, if you notice closely, this is a line which is walking through it, right? This is the line which is walking through it. Now, I have already explained you how we calculate that which line is the best line. Now, this, as I said, we will see this in example also. So can you notice we are doing the same thing? What is this yi? I told you, right? Let's say this is an actual value and this is a predicted value. So we find out the difference between them, right? We found out the distance between them. That is what we are doing here. Yi minus y naught means this value minus this value. Okay. So let's say this value is 120 and this predicted value is, let's say, 110. So the difference is 10. And then we are doing the whole square and sum of the values. Remember, we have seen that in that example. That is what we are doing for all the lines. Whichever is going to give me the least value will be my final value. So this sort of summation, what we do is called as least square errors. Okay. So we have already seen this in example. Now this should be very easy for you. You should be very easily able to find out what exactly we are doing. And as I said, right, this is called as also residual, the difference. So this is also called as prediction error or residual error. Same example which I explained you beforehand. So this is just a computation of the whole thing for two different lines. Again, whichever is going to give me the least value, like you can see for W1 line, I'm getting 597. So let's see my W1 line. Can you see I have two lines, W1 and W2. So in this case, whichever line is going to give me the least value is going to be my final line. That is what we're going to do. So in this case, again, the same story. So W1 line is giving me the least value. That's the reason we are going to take up that line. Now let's understand the linear regression with the help of another example. Okay, so let's take some more examples. So that's how it's the best way to learn something. Now, let's say there is a company where there are a lot of people leaving. Okay, there was a recent appraisal, and after that appraisal, they noticed that a lot of people started just quitting that company. Now that company want to find out what exactly went wrong. So what they kind of created a table is that they created a salary hike, like how much hike we have given to a particular person and what is the churnout rate for that. Means if we have given, let's say, 1580 hike, then basically what's the churnout rate if we have given this? How many people kind of left? That is what we are keeping in this side. Let's see if we can draw some relationship between them. On my x-axis, if you notice, I am putting my salary hike option. On my y-axis, I am putting my churn rate, means people who are leaving me. Now, if I plot a graph, can you see that they are negatively related, right? Because if you notice, my value is coming like this. Means when I am increasing the salary more, there is less churnout rate. And that is pretty obvious, right? If you give a person more salary hike, he will be happy. And why he would like to leave them, right? He will be staying in that company. If you give a person low hike, then he will curse his boss and will say, I'm not going to work here because this boss is intentionally not giving me good hike, right? So that is going to happen. That's a very general thing. So if you give more hike, definitely there is less likeliness of a person leaving that particular job. So we can do this portion. Now similarly, if we talk about use cases of linear regressions, there are not many. In real estate, let's say if I have a house and I want to predict the price I should quote for that. Now you can do that with the help of some data which is present for your area or locality. Based on that, you can do a prediction. Now similarly, in medicines, in your demand forecasting, in your marketing, and lot many domains, you can use this linear regression. Like for example, a company want to predict that what will be the stock price next month. They can even apply here also linear regression to do that. Like I said, even the investors are using this. Investors are using this linear regression to kind of estimate that whether the startup is going to make profit or not. So they are becoming smart now. They don't want to invest their hard-earned money just like that. They want to ensure that you are going to make profit. So they don't want to take the risk of 50-50. They kind of predict whether this startup is going to make profit or not with the help of a lot of details what they have with you. And then they are going to make a predictions. I'm going to say that, okay, we are interested or not interested. Now, let's talk about a use case. Let's see one of the interesting example with this. So let's say a real estate consultant firm has a data which is comprising some price of the apartments in Boston. Okay, so in Boston City, let's say you have a data of all the prices of the apartment. Based on this data, company want to predict the price of the new apartment. So they have the data of the old apartments, what they have, that okay, if these are the details of this kind of house, then this was the price on which it was sold. Then if I have a new apartment, then what should the price I should keep up for that? So that is what we wanted to do in this case. So I'm going to show you this thing in practical also. Don't worry about that. So right now let's understand what's gonna happen. So let's draw, basically, first of all, we are going to use this library bus, which contains this Boston dataset. Now, if you look at this Boston dataset, this is how your Boston dataset looks like. Now, if you want to go and read the details about Boston dataset, because we are using R programming language, you can write question mark and just the dataset part. It will show you that what are the column details. It will also give a lot of details in that. So you can just basically check that by using this question mark Boston. So this is how this will appear. You can see that it has the details like crime, what is the crime rate there. There are a lot of details like how many average rooms are there, what is the age of units built prior to 1940, tax, property rates, all those things are being defined. And in the end, we are predicting the value of your house. Okay. In MEVV, we are predicting the value of your house. Means this is the last, let's say the actual value, what we need to predict it. So in this case, what we are going to do, we are going to keep 70% of the data on which we are going to apply our training. Okay, we are going to generate a model with the help of 70% data. And on remaining 30% data, we are going to do prediction. That is what we are going to do. And then we will compare our prediction with our actual value. That is what we are going to do. What I mean by that means, if I, in my data set, let's say I have 100 values, if I have 100 data, what I am going to do, so I am going to only consider 70 data, 70 values. I am going to only pull out 70 values for now. And from that 70 values, I am going to train my data set. Okay, I am going to train my data set with these 70 values. I am going to generate a model. Remember that line? Linear regression line, that is what we are going to draw. Then from that, whatever model we have drawn, remaining 30 data, we are going to start predicting on it, and we will see that how close our prediction is done. Okay, so that is what we are going to do in this particular example. So let's do that. So in this case, how we can split up the values in a, so first of all, we are going to use seed value just in order to ensure that we get the same random values. We are going to use this library CA tools. We are going to split this value by 70% by using the split API of R. Now we are splitting by 70%. And then if you notice, the true value I am going to consider. So this is going to be my training set. This is going to be my testing data set. Okay. So let's move further. Now let's check out the plot, how the plot will look like. So the plot, if we generate on this, so this is how the output will look like. So if you notice, this is a very general graph. If you notice here, at some places I will be seeing the negative linear regression. Somewhere I will be seeing the positive linear trend. For example, if you see the RM, let's see, RM is where? Here. Okay. And if I take the other value, MEDV. Now, can you see this value is going up, right? My prediction is going up in this case. Now, similarly, you can catch up other values. Can you see here it is coming down, right? It is here, it is common. So similarly, I can see even other values, wherever it is impacting, wherever it is in impacting. Can you see? This is also a kind of making a positive impact, right? This is making a negative impact. So that is what you can see from this particular graph. So you can easily identify the relationship here. Similarly, this is again some more predictions you can infer from it. Now, look at this. Now, if I want to find out the correlation between two variables, by correlation, I mean how two variables are strongly related with each other. For example, your age, your experience kind of implies more salary, right? So that these two variables are highly correlated with each other. That's what we want to find. So you can do that with the help of COR command. Then you are putting Boston, so it will show you that what all variables are highly correlated with each other. So in this case, if you notice, whichever value is showing in blue color, dark blue, that means they're highly correlated. Whichever is in red color, it means they're negatively correlated. So that is what they mean. Now, definitely, if you notice this portion, look at this part. All are blue in color. How come? Because definitely, this is also Zn. This is also Zn. So a variable will be 100% correlated with the same variable, right? That's the reason you are seeing this blue color thing here. Now, if you notice this red color, right? So you can see that dist and Indus, they are negatively correlated with each other. Means if one value is increasing, other value is going to decrease. So that is what denotes by a red color. Intermediate colors means they denote kind of correlation. Means this kind of things are good correlation values, in fact. Okay, so they are related with each other. So that is what being denoted here. So we can do that with the help of COR and drawing this score plot. You can see this graph which we have just understood. Now, here I just said, right? So basically, you can see that which are negatively correlated, which are positively correlated. So if you want to see positive MEDV and RM, look at that. Where is MEDV? Let's see that. This is MEDV and RM. Where is that RM? Now notice this is blue color, right? So they are positively correlated with each other. That is what this graph is representing. Now there is something called as multicolorality also. So in this, if you notice here, what's going to happen? Like if you notice this prediction values, let's say if you notice this X1, X2 prediction, can you see they are less overlapped, right? That means they don't have much correlation. If you notice this portion, they are highly correlated here, right? So this thing is called even as a multicolorality. So we want to even remove that because in that case, we are going to get less information if they are highly multicolored. So we can use BIF function to do that. So you can notice that we can use this library card and there we have this BIF function. So this BIF function can give you this kind of output. Now, if BIF is 1, means there is no correlation between the variable. If it is very high, it means there is a highly correlation. Now you can see this RAD have a very high value and you can also see that we have this 8.5. This also is a very high value, right? They are kind of multicollinear values. So this BIF is going to show me all this part. You can also see the same thing with this portion. This is also one graph which you can generate. Using this graph also, you can just see that wherever it is 1, it means they're highly correlated. And that is very obvious also. If you look at this, this is very highly obvious. Definitely CIM will be highly correlated with CIM. Zn will be highly correlated with Zn, right? Now, but if you notice this, let's say RM, and if you pull up from here tax, now can you see RM tax here? Or you can also notice that there must be whichever, see this part, 0.91, okay? Means this tax and this RAD, they are highly correlated. So that is what you can infer from this. Moving further. Now, if you see a summary, you will notice all this value. So now in this case, if you notice, if you see summary, it will show you the minimum value, residual, all these values it will show. It will also show you the p-value. We will understand the significance part of p-value. In fact, the p-value, the more lower the p-value, the more significant that variable is for your model. And I say more significant, that means we should consider that variable to build that model. And generally, we try to keep the p-value less than 0.05, means less than 5%. Okay, if the value is less than this 5%, that means it's a good p-value. Okay, that means it's a more significant value, I should say. So that is what we mean here. And in fact, you can notice this stars. It is denoting 2 to the power e minus 16. That means that's very low, right? 3 stars means it is very highly significant because it's equivalent to like 0%. 2 stars also is good, means it means like 1% kind of thing, 0.1%, I should say. This 1 star means 1%. A dot means 5%. Below that means it is not much significant variable. We will see all this in practical also. Now, similarly, you can draw a linear model now. So you can draw a linear model by using LM function. So right now you're defining all your variables. Then you can just find out this R square also by using, after this model, you can create a summary of it. In summary, you will find all this p-value. Now you can notice all the significant values. Notice this. Whichever is going to be closer to 1 means it's highly significant, right? So you can do this. Now this is not very significant. So you can remove it if you want. In this, you can remove it. Similarly, whichever is not significant, you can remove this from your model. So that is what you can also do. Now, if I move further, if your R square is near to 1, it means it's a good model. If R square is not near to 1, that means it's not a very good. You can notice this R square thing. So R square, you can notice from here, all these values, right? So if it is near to 1, then in that case, it's a good model. Otherwise, it's not a good model. That's what your R square denotes. We will see all this thing in practical also, don't worry. So p-value, I've just already explained you this portion. Now you can also generate it by excluding your index and age, which were not significant, as we have seen with the p-value part. Now you can notice that now if I do a summary, we will not see any of the insignificant value. So we can remove all the variables where we were not seeing any star or dot. Means their p-value was greater than, let's say it is going to be greater than your basically 5%. That is what this means. So here now, if you have a data set and you want to predict now, you can do that with your test data sets. These are your prediction values. Now, if you plot basically your prediction and your actual values, you will see a graph something like this. And if you notice, my green color and my blue color, they're almost going identical way, right? Not much difference. That means my prediction is very good. My prediction which is coming out is really a good prediction. Now, if you have, let's say, a new data set, and you want to predict the price of your house. So as you can see here, you can easily predict it because you have the model function, the model which you have created. In that, you can pass your sample data and then this should be a predicted output. So that is how you can do it. Now, let me just show all these things in practical. For that, we require to open our RStudio. So let's do that. So let me show you how RStudio looks like. This is our RStudio where we can execute our R code. Now, like if you are a Java developer, you might have used Eclipse and all. Similarly, for R users, this is what being used. Now, if you notice, this is my whole code, which is in front of you, which I just explained. Now, let's execute it line by line and see that whether the same incidents are happening or not. So, first of all, I'm going to execute my library mask. I'm going to load that. Then going to bring this data Boston and going to read this data. So, let's do that. So, as you can notice, this is my data of Boston, okay? So I have crime rate and all those values which we have seen. Now let's go there. Now let's say if I want to see the data of Boston, I can say question mark Boston. Now on your right hand side, you can see a help page which is coming up, right? Now this contains all the value for your Boston. So like it has crime, Jaden, right? What is exactly all these variables means, you can check it by using this question mark. So this question mark means the help page basically. Now we want to load this CA tools. We are also doing a seed so that every time random values remain same. So let's execute that. Now here we are splitting the data by 70%. So we are creating a training data set and a testing data set. So we have already understood that in our slide. So let's execute that now. So this is my training data set and testing data set. Now what? Let's say now plot something. So let's do a plot. Can you see? In this plot, we are plotting with respect to crime rate and price. So definitely when your crime rate is high, your price for that house is going to decrease. So that is what is showing up in this graph. Now, in this function, we are finding the correlations of the all the values in Boston. We have already understood that what we mean by correlation here. Now let's attach this data set Boston, and then let's do one more plot to see some more things. I am going to draw a scatter plot, in fact. Look at this. This is the part which we have also seen in our PPT. Now this, if you notice, is negatively correlated, right? So as we can see from here, that the shape of the graph is telling me that what all the values which are positively correlated or negatively correlated. We can also draw one more way. So let's do this regression of plot, and with tab line, see this. If I have the data like this, I can draw a linear regression line like this. So I was able to do that because I've used this LM function, and on top of that, we have called this tab line function. Now let's draw one more core plot. Look at this. Let me zoom this. Now can you see the value which are near to 1 are going to be highly correlated. The value which are near to 0 are negatively correlated. So you can notice here that there was value 0.91, right? Means tax and rad, they are highly correlated. That is what this graph is representing. But this is more cleaner representation, right? In comparison to your old one. Now let's say you want to find the multicollinearity. You can also do that. So after that, we want to remove the data. Let's say I want to remove MEDV column, we can do that. We are converting to numeric. Then we are finding the score values and all. So let's do that. So this is what we have done. So we are going to exclude it. Now let's apply this VIF to check this multicollinearity. I need not restart this. Okay. Look at this. This is my current multicollinearity. If you notice, these values are very high, right? RAT and basically tax. That's the reason they were giving the high correlation also. Now let's create a model. So let's do that. So I can either use this dot option. This dot option denotes that all the variables should be included, or I can one by one, I can use this plus sign and can give all my variable names. So all the independent variables I need to keep up here. So this is my dependent variable. These are all my independent variables. So let's execute any one of them. So my linear model is ready. Now if I do a summary of this, so you can see this, right? Now currently, if you notice this age, right? Even if this index, they're not making any similarities because this p-value, this last is p-value. This is actually very high. So I only want to consider which is less than 5%, which will show me some stars or dot. So I only want to consider that, so I can remove them. So let's remove them. I can remove the text enough. So let's do that. Now notice, I have, when I draw this, it did not make much impact. Now age is also having no significance. I can remove that also. So let's remove that and then see a summary of that. You will notice a better model impact. Now notice, everything coming here is with star, means all the p values are less than that. Also, you should notice the R square value. R square value should be near to 1. That gives a good one. Now let's do a prediction. Let's do a prediction. Now, so this is my prediction output for the new test. Remember, I have done it 70%, 30%. So this I am doing for 30% data. Remaining 30% data, I am doing this now on the testing data set. Now what I should do? Now let me just plot a graph between the actual value of testing set and whatever the predicted value we have got. So let's do that. Can you see? This is very close, right? Very close, this blue line and green line, very close. That means my prediction is coming very nicely. Now if I have a new data set, if I want to predict with that, we can also do it. So let's say if I have a new data set called as sample underscore data, I can also be able to predict a new value if even I have any sort of old data. This is how overall your linear regression works. Now let me again go back to my PPT. So definitely this was just a kind of a small session of linear regression just to show you the power of that. Now in Edureka, we do have a course of this data science where we kind of walk over all these machine learning algorithms along with even on the big data, how you work on machine learning algorithms and all. So there we go in a lot more details even when we go to linear regression. So all those things you will be learning it there in detail. You can also see some testimonials of what students say about Edureka and all. You can read about it on your own. that there are a lot of good testimonials being coming up in the data science, because this is one of the most complicated course and Edureka is helping it to make it easier. So this is one, just a small part, but just as you can say, it's a small, just a subset of linear regression what we have talked in this class. In that session, we not only start talking with respect to R, because definitely I'm not assuming that you know R language at the moment. We go over R and then we finish up a lot of things. Amit is asking a question, do we have projects like this in our course? Yes, we do have a lot of projects in our course like that. So each topic, in fact, if we talk linear regression, we have a project. You talk about classification, there will be a use case and project. So everything is going to have a project, followed by in the end, there is going to be a big project in the end. That's going to give you a very good understanding of how this data science things works there. So there will be a lot of project work. So if I get stuck, then who is going to help me is the question from Ayushi side. Okay, so there is a 24/7 support from Edureka, where exactly if you get stuck at any particular moment, so basically you have to just call them up or drop a support ticket, they will immediately get back to you. So it's 24/7 support. So it doesn't matter in whichever country you live, from where you are coming from, it really doesn't matter. You just need to raise a support ticket. Within few hours, you will be getting a response. Even in your project, if you get stuck at any place, you can actually do that. How can I enroll for this course? You can just get connected with Edureka team. Basically, there's our phone numbers. They are available on the site. You can call them up. They will be helping you across, in guiding you across throughout this course. There are, these courses keeps on happening very frequently in Edureka. And you will get all the guidance from them. So this is about the course. As I said, data science is the course where you kind of get to know all these details. So this is all about which we wanted to talk in today's session. Any other question from anyone? Any other question from anyone related to Edureka, related to the course? Okay, great. So thank you everyone. I hope you have found this useful and hope to see you in Edureka classes. Thank you everyone.
I hope you enjoyed listening to this video. Please be kind enough to like it, and you can comment any of your doubts and queries, and we will reply to them at the earliest. Do look out for more videos in our playlist and subscribe to our Edureka channel to learn more. Happy learning!